Would you please stand for the opening hymn? Resurrection and the life, says the Lord. Whoever believes in me, though he die, yet shall he live. And everyone who lives and believes in me shall never die. For I know that my Redeemer lives, and that at the last he will stand upon the earth. And after my skin has been thus destroyed, yet in my flesh I shall see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not another. For none of us lives to himself, and none of us dies to himself. For if we live, we live to the Lord, and if we die, we die to the Lord. So then, whether we live or whether we die, we are the Lord's. For we brought nothing into the world, and it is certain we carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord has taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed are the dead who die in the Lord. Even so, says the Spirit, for they rest from their labors. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. O God, who by the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, destroyed death and brought life and immortality to light, grant that your servant Joseph, being raised with Christ, may know the strength of his presence and rejoice in his eternal glory, who with you and the Holy Spirit lives and reigns, one God, forever and ever. Amen. Most merciful God, whose wisdom is beyond our understanding, deal graciously with those who mourn, especially Joseph's family and friends. Surround them with your love, that they may not be overwhelmed by their loss, but have confidence in your goodness and strength to meet the days to come, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Please be seated for the readings.
A reading from the book of Lamentations. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. The Lord is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will hope in him. The Lord is good to those who wait for him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that one should wait quietly for the salvation of the Lord, for the Lord will not cast off forever. But though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love, for he does not afflict from his heart or grieve the children of men. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. If you'd look in your bulletin, in Psalm 23, would you join me and say it together? The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He maketh me to lie down in green pastures. He leadeth me beside the still waters. He restoreth my soul. He leadeth me in the paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. Thou preparest a table before me in the presence of mine enemies. Thou anointest my head with oil, and my cup runneth over. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. A reading from the letter of Paul to the Romans. And we know, for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. The word of the Lord.
The saddlebags are for Joe Kidd and his love of the trail, his love of you. Sharon, I want to say a word to you. You have been an incredible mate for 63 years, and you do not have to for one micro nanosecond look over your shoulder and say, you know, I wish I'd done this for Joe. I wish I'd helped him with this, or why didn't I do that? You don't have to do that because you've been Phi Beta Kappa and an example, a shining example to all of us. And I want to thank you from each and every one of us. Joseph Neal Kidd. Dr. Kidd. Babu to his family. Captain Kidd on the water. Or just plain Joe. To most of us, and certainly Joe Kidd, MD. This is indeed a celebration service of Joe's life. It's really a graduation service. There's some young people in this family, and a lot of us older have been to a lot of graduations. They graduate them now from kindergarten, you know, to lower school to middle school to high school, then you go on to college and post-grad degrees, and it just kind of, the graduation just kind of keeps on going. But this graduation, I submit to you, is the one that counts the most, because this graduation, the Joe Neal Kidd graduation, the Joe graduation lasts forever. It is indeed the ultimate graduation. I know that you know that Joe Kidd had his MD degree, but you might not know that he also had and has a PhD degree. And that stands for Permanent Heavenly Days. That's our Joe. So I pray that we come today as Easter people, as the back of your bulletin says, this is a resurrection service. And if we come as Easter people, we come in victory. people of the resurrection who know Christ as their Lord and Savior. In the book of John, in the first chapter, in the 12th verse, it'll come to me. But we know where Joe is right now, in heaven, forever and for always. I want to talk a little bit about some of the characteristics and qualities of Joe Kidd. I asked Sharon this morning, what were some of your first thoughts? And she said, really? Three words. Husband, father, and healer. And then I asked Melanie, what were some of you things that you thought about it? And she said, he was bigger than life. He could make anything happen. If he would just imagine, if you could imagine it, he could make it happen. And Joey, you said, jolly Joe, hard worker, intense. Boy, that's a good word for Joe. At work or at play, full speed ahead, at work or at play. I have some thoughts about Joe since I've known him for 61 years. He was a sophomore at Baylor. I was a sophomore undergraduate. He was in Baylor Med. I was a sophomore in undergrad school at Johns Hopkins. And we met in 1963 in the operating room where Denton Cooley was the surgeon in chief. We've been close friends for all that time since. Travels and trails and water and riding and fishing and all of that. And in all that, I can tell you that Joe Kidd was a warrior and a champion for his family, for his many friends, and certainly for his patients. He was just an amazing guy. I mean, absolutely amazing. He was fun. There were good times with Joe Kidd while, and that's fine, good times when he was around. Adventuresome he was, a man of laughter. When he'd really get going, he'd start shaking. If he really got going, he'd start coughing. And he'd call me on the phone, and he wouldn't, my last name is Barksdale, and so my nickname is Barky, and so he would just start barking like a dog. He wouldn't say anything. And I'd just bark back at him, and then we'd both just laugh for a while, and then we'd start talking. But he was an incredibly super intelligent individual. Bold, unafraid, confident, exciting, a man's man. A project man, always needing to be doing something. He was a worker. I remember seeing him in the engine room on the boat. He'd come up out of that engine room after changing filters or changing seals, and you know, it's hot in the engine room anyway, and he'd just be soaking wet from head to foot, but he was working. He had a strong handshake. If you shook hands with Joe Kidd, you knew you were shaking hands with a working man, a surgeon, but a hard working man. He worked with his hands. He was actually irrepressible, and he was also inspirational. Joey's a physician, Melanie's a physician. They followed that model after their dad. Actually, Joe was the quintessential alpha male, the pure essence of an alpha male. If you looked up alpha in the dictionary, his picture would be right there. He was strong-willed. He was bullheaded. He was large and in charge. He was tough. He was, in cowboy terminology, a hooking bull. He was one of a kind. Now, as a result of that, there was often some controversy. There was conflict. There was some clashing. There's some confrontation. There was some contention. That's Joe Kidd. Juxtaposed to that, there are some incredible characteristics that I have personally observed as well. Compassionate, comforting, concerned, caring, and considerate. Just a plain and simple gifted guy. Well, for right now, that's enough about Joe. I want to talk about Sharon for a second. I want to talk about the love story. Some of you know this, some of you don't, but you need to know it. You can't make this up, folks. They met at age 12 in the 7th grade in junior high school. Back in the day when you could go to the drive-in, nobody locked their front door, their back door, and they're at the drive-in in the 7th grade, just hanging out. Here's the first thing Joe Kidd said to Sharon. You're going to really be cute when you get to high school. And lo and behold, in the 9th grade, they had their first date. They went to a movie. And they'd go to MYF, Methodist Youth Fellowship, after church on Sundays as they went to the same church. And then Joe told a friend, a close friend, he said, you know, I dreamed I was going to marry that girl. And indeed they did on June the 1st, 1961. They drove to Baylor the next day to go to summer school so that Joe and Sharon could graduate in 3 years and he could get on to med school. What are some of the things that Joe Kidd loved? He loved this family. He loved them individually. He loved them collectively. And believe me, he was a force for his family. Top priority. There were a lot of trips. There were ski trips. There were trips rafting on the Colorado River for a week. Just all kind of family stuff, rides and what have you. And two of his special trips with Sherry was a passage on the Nile River and then an African 21-day safari in the bush. And Joe loved hunting in the outdoors, as Africa implies. But I was on hunts with him in New Mexico for elk and mule deer, and in Montana for elk and mule deer, and for white wings in Valley in South Texas. He loved the water, and he loved boats. His first boat was named the Sherry K. Way to go, Joe. The second was the Bypasser. The third one was the Triple Bypasser. And the little boat, the little dinghy, was called the Redo. And then you'll have to figure out why this name fits with Joe Kidd, but one of their boats was called High Tension. That's perfect. So trips to the Bahamas, trips to the Florida Keys, trip to the Sea of Cortez, fishing, spearfishing, scuba diving. Joe loved horses and the trail. I've said earlier, he loved the West. He was a member of the El Paso Sheriff's Mounted Posse, and I think I went with him on his first trail ride with the posse. And if I hadn't gone on that posse ride with Joe Kidd, there's a guy on that ride I wouldn't have met. And if I hadn't met that guy, I probably wouldn't be in the ministry right now for almost 40 years. So Joe Kidd, indirectly, is responsible for me being in the ministry. So that shows you God has a sense of humor. So we've been on mountain hunts together. And how about Joe's Kentucky Derby horse, Joe and Sharon's horse, Bold Ego? Does that work for anybody? Is that a good name for Joe Kidd's horse? You bet. And then in medicine, truly gifted as a surgeon, committed, dedicated, saving many lives and lengthening, no telling how many lives. I mean, and how much more family time his patients were able to have because of the gifts that God gave him. In business, he was an entrepreneur. He was a Coors distributor here in El Paso at the same time I was a Coors distributor in Houston and Galveston. And so we actually kind of wound up in the same business for a while. And then he had an air freight business from here, from Mexico to Detroit with auto parts. I got to tell you just a couple of really quick stories about Joe, and this is emblematic. Absolutely. We're in the Bahamas on the boat, and he was reading a bunch of charts, and he had his sunglasses on. He took his sunglasses on. He put them down a little bit too hard, and they just broke right in half, right in the middle, right on the bridge. And I said, oh, thank goodness. He said, what do you mean, thank goodness? I said, Joe, that's the ugliest pair of sunglasses I've ever seen in my life. It's time to say goodbye. He said, you don't know about these sunglasses. He said, let me tell you. He said, I was in Las Vegas, and we went into a store, and I bought this pair and another pair. And I put them at the cashier, and the guy looked up at me, and he said, are you sure you want to buy these sunglasses? And Joe said, well, you see them on the counter there, don't you? He was challenged because this guy asked him, do you really want to buy these? And so he gave him a bill for $5,000 for two pairs of sunglasses. So there you go, Joe Kidd. The guy put ketchup on the finest beef that you can imagine. Joe, how's that steak? Oh, it's really good. You could put enough ketchup on a spare tire and it would be good. So I've had a lot of fun kidding with Joe. And he also always put ice in his red wine. I said, Joe, this is a really fine Bordeaux. Are you sure? Absolutely. Put some more ice in it. So just an absolute, absolute classic. 3 years ago this month, we were at Alto with Joe and Sharon at their house in the mountains. And one day we came in from just being out in the morning. We sat around the kitchen table. And we started talking about Kendall. And we started talking about Kendall. Everything kind of came out. It all came out. And we started talking about knowing that she was with the Lord. And started talking with Joe about knowing that he and all of us were going to be with the Lord. And how important that was. And I secured for myself that day at that kitchen table, for me personally, bawling like a baby, I don't mind telling you, I know Joe Kidd knows the Lord Jesus Christ as his personal Lord and Savior. I remember that. And Kendall has been with the Lord for 42 years. And now her daddy is with this little girl forever and forever and forever. And I might just remind you, when you have a tear for Joe or anybody in the family, or the family has a tear, that kind of the basic building blocks for life are in a human tear. There's water, there's salt, and there's protein. It's all right there. So tears are for healing, and they're a wonderful thing to have, and they're a very powerful thing to have. I know that you know that Joe Kidd loved the West. Western art, all the things we talked about. I want to read something to you now from a book called Trails Plowed Under. It was written by Charlie Russell, the great Western artist. And the foreword was written by the great Will Rogers. And I want to read you just a condensed, super hyper condensed version of that. And what I'd like for you to do is just pretend that you wrote Joe that letter, just like Will Rogers wrote his best friend that letter. So let's see how it goes. And I'm going to get the book out. One of Charlie Russell's paintings on the front. And the letter goes like this. 1926 written. The book was published in 1927. "Hello, Joe, old hand. How are you? I just thought I'd drop you a line and tell you how things are working here on the old range since you left. Old timer, we don't know. You don't know how we miss you, but gee, it's been lonesome since you left. Even to us way down here in Texas, where we don't get to see near as much of you as we wanted to anyhow. There ain't much news here to tell you. You know the big boss gent sent a hand over and got you so quick, Joe. But I guess he needed a good man pretty bad. I hear they've been working shorthanded over there pretty much all the time. I guess it's hard for him to get a hold of good men. They're just getting scarce everywhere. But you was gone one morning before the old cook could roll out. But after we had realized it, you had rolled your bed and gone. It sure would have done your old hide good to have seen what they all thought of you. You know how it is yourself with a fellow leaving an outfit and going over to another. In talking it over after he is gone, there's generally a but somewhere in there somewhere. Some old peeler will unload some dirt about him, but there sure wasn't any after you crossed the skyline. Why, it would have been almost worth your going to a new outfit just to have heard all the fine things said about you. Darn it, when I get to thinking about it all, them top hands up there, if I could just hold a horse wrangling job with them, I wouldn't mind following that wagon myself. At first, we couldn't understand why they moved you, but we can now. They had every kind of great man up there, but they just didn't have any great cowboy like you. Shucks, on the luck. There was only one of you, and he couldn't use you in both places. Well, I can't write you anymore, Joe. Darn paper's all wet. It must be raining in this old bunkhouse. Of course, we're all just hanging on here as long as we can. I don't know why we hate to go. We know it's better there. Maybe it's because we haven't done anything that will live after we're gone," referring to his art. But Joe Kidd's done a lot of things that I believe will live after he's gone. Look at this family. Look at the legacy. Look at the heritage. And that verse I couldn't remember a while ago goes like this. "To as many as received him," that's Christ. "To those he gave the power to be the sons and the daughters of God, even to those who believe upon his name." So I know that Joe Kidd is a child of the King. And as such, and as a fisherman, we could say the fisherman's prayer. "I pray that I may live to fish until my dying day. And when it comes to my last cast, then I most humbly pray. When in the Lord's great landing net and peacefully asleep, that in his mercy I be judged big enough to keep." And I can promise you Joe Kidd is big enough to keep. And I can promise you something else. He wants you in that landing net with him and with Kendall. Because the last time I checked, the mortality rate was still 100%. So you need to know that you know that you know the Lord Jesus Christ. And maybe this resurrection service is a perfect time for that. Thank you for Joe Kidd.
Thank you, Pastor Barksdale. Would you please stand for the gospel hymn?
Holy Gospel of our Lord Jesus Christ according to Luke.
Glory to you.
And the Pharisees and their scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, "Why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus answered them, "Those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." The Gospel of the Lord.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. Go ahead and be seated, folks. Thank you for coming out for this service. I know it means a lot to the family, and Sharon especially. And thank you, Pastor Barksdale. That was wonderful, wonderful tribute to Joe. And this part of the service is where I just share a little bit about the scriptures, and I don't really know, haven't really had the chance to find out why y'all picked these scriptures. You can pick whatever scriptures you want, but I want to comment on them in light of what Pastor Barksdale was talking about in terms of knowing the Lord. In our Old Testament reading from the Hebrew Bible, Lamentations 3, 22 through 26 and 31 through 33, this is an amazing scripture when you think about it, because if you know anything about the book of Lamentations, it was written, it doesn't sound like a happy book, right? Lamentations. It was written by the prophet Jeremiah, who, by the way, was called the weeping prophet. And if you know that, you know why he was called the weeping prophet. It's because God told him that he was going to be bringing judgment on his own people And he tried to tell them, and he tried to warn the king, and he got punished for doing so. He got punished for speaking the truth over and over again. And ultimately, he saw the destruction of Jerusalem, the city of God. And it was, he saw the people of God taken into exile as captives. And it was devastating, the death, the suffering that he saw. And in the middle of that, his faith in God allowed him to write these words: "The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end." Now that's faith. It's faith to be able to see a terrible situation, a tragedy. You all have experienced tragedy in your family, especially with Kendall's death. And there's not hardly anybody in El Paso who was around at that time who didn't know about that. It's just amazing to hear people talk about it. It's still 42 years later, it's still fresh. Terrible, terrible tragedy. But faith can be in the midst of a terrible situation and say, God's mercies never end. He is faithful. They're new every morning. Great is his faithfulness. And there's, of course, a wonderful hymn about that. Probably many hymns, but some with the exact words. The Lord is my portion, says my soul, therefore I will hope in him. When there's no hope, and I don't know, perhaps some of you just feel devastated by Joe's death. I mean, we all know it's coming one of these days, but when it comes, it's devastating. Someone we love is taken, and there's a big empty hole. It hurts. Hope believes. Hope believes. Now, we don't just have hope for hope's sake. We believe in something. We have hope in something. And Pastor Barksdale alluded to that. He said it clearly. We have hope for what happens after this life. And unfortunately, a lot of people don't understand that a relationship with God doesn't have to start after this life. It begins now. When Jesus said, "He who believes in me has eternal life," he wasn't just saying, when you die, you go to heaven. He was saying, you'll have eternal life now. This is eternal life, to know him. It's a different world. It's like Jesus told the ruler Nicodemus when he said, you cannot see the kingdom of God unless you are born anew, unless you're born by the Spirit of God. You'll walk around and you will not see anything. But those who have had the Spirit come into their life and into their heart have their eyes opened, and they see the Lord everywhere, everywhere. They can see the kingdom of God in this life. And so this scripture is an encouragement. It says we wait for his salvation. Sometimes we're waiting. For the Lord will not cast off forever, but though he cause grief, he will have compassion according to the abundance of his steadfast love. For he does not afflict from his heart or grieve the children of men. It's a weird translation. Different Bibles say it. He does not willingly cause suffering. But we live in a world that has fallen. We live in a world where suffering is a reality. It's a reality every day. And we're naive if we think we can go through life without suffering. And death is one of the greatest of sufferings. for not only for those who die, but for their loved ones when they have to experience the loss. But knowing that Joe is with the Lord, and I think that makes a big difference to a lot of people to know that. You know, when Jesus used that little analogy about being born anew, I think we ought to think about that a second, because birth is in itself a process. It's not necessarily like that, right? I mean, there's 9 months and then there's a birth. And some people, it takes them a long time to spiritually gestate until they get to that point where they know that they know the Lord. And some people, it's overnight, you know. St. Paul, it was like that. He saw Jesus on the road to Damascus. Who art thou, Lord? I am Jesus whom thou persecutest. Oh, okay. What do you want me to do? Paul recognized the Messiah when he revealed himself to him. We read in Romans, all things work together for good to those who are called to love, to those who are called according to his purpose. You see, I'm sorry, but Pastor Barksdale and I probably started with the King James Version, and it's a little different. It says, for all things work together for good to those who love him, who are called according to his purpose. Why'd they take that out, Pastor? I want to know. Anyway, to those who love him, to those who are called according to his purpose. And that's a verse that a lot of us hang on to throughout life. I mean, we hang on to that verse. It doesn't just say all things work together for good, period. To those who know him, to those who trust in him, every situation, if offered to God, he will work together for good. And we say, well, how can that be? The answer is in the next verse. It says, for those whom he foreknew, he predestined to be conformed to his image, to the image of his son. In other words, even the sufferings that we experience are shaping us into the persons that God intends us to be. It doesn't say all things work together to make us happy. It says they all work together for good. And when we follow Jesus Christ, his spirit is shaping our lives, our character, through the normal experiences of life, until we get to that place where we are ready to be with him forever. And I believe, and I've said this, I think, to the family, that God has the number of each of our days written in his book. He knows how long each of us will live. And I know you say, well, what about the person in a car accident, or what about the person who has a disease? I don't care. I know all those things are factors, but God knew from before we were born how long we would be here. And as the pastor said, we don't know how long we'll be here. And we need to know that we have a Savior. I'm just going to finish up with this beautiful verse, this beautiful scripture. And I don't know why the family chose this, but I think I have a suspicion. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled at his disciples, saying, why do you eat and drink with tax collectors and sinners? And Jesus answered them, those who are well have no need of a physician, but those who are sick. I have not come to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Jesus likened himself to a physician. And the medicine that he dispensed was God's forgiveness, God's redemption, eternal life, his presence in our hearts. That was what Jesus was here to bring. Another way of talking about the kingdom of God. But the key, he says, is, and this is available to everybody. It's available to everybody. But only those who are willing to say, Lord, I need a Savior. Only those who understand that they cannot be good enough ever in their lives to make God say, okay, well, you get into heaven. There's nobody in this planet from Adam and Eve till the last person who ever lives that will ever be good enough for God to say that to them. There was only one man that was that good, Jesus. And so to receive all the benefits that God wants to give us, all the free gifts that he wants to give us, all we have to do is say, I'm sorry, Lord, for all the years that I've tried to live in control of my own life. Now I want you to be in control. And I'm sorry for sinning against you and one my fellow man. And please forgive me and come into my heart. That's all we have to do to begin that journey of walking with him. And so we are all, we're in this story. We are the sinners. We all are. And we are the ones that Jesus came to save. We are. And if we think we're too righteous for that, then we don't qualify for salvation. To qualify for salvation, you have to be a sinner who recognizes that he's a sinner who needs a Savior, and that's Jesus. So with that, I'm going to just pray, Father, thank you for this opportunity again to celebrate not just Joe, but to celebrate his Savior, and that he and his Savior are united now forever. Amen.
Almighty God, you knit together your elect in one communion and fellowship in the mystical body of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Grant, we pray, to your whole church in heaven and on earth, your light and peace. Lord, in your mercy, grant that all who have been baptized into Christ's death and resurrection may die to sin and rise to newness of life, that through the grave and gate of death, we may pass with him to our joyful resurrection. Lord, in your mercy, grant to us who are still in our pilgrimage and who walk as yet by faith, that your Holy Spirit may lead us in holiness and righteousness all our days. Lord, in your mercy, grant to your faithful people pardon and peace, that we may be cleansed from all our sins and serve you in faithful obedience. Lord, in your mercy, grant to all who mourn a sure confidence in your fatherly care, that casting their grief on you, they may know the consolation of your love. Lord, in your mercy, grant us grace to entrust Joseph to your never-failing love. Receive him into the arms of your mercy and remember him according to the favor which you show to all your people. Lord, in your mercy, Grant that increasing in knowledge and love of you, he may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service in your heavenly kingdom. Lord, in your mercy. Almighty God, grant us, with all who have died in the hope of the resurrection, the fullness of life in your eternal and everlasting glory, and with all your saints, to receive the crown of life promised to all who share in the victory of your Son, Jesus Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's change the peace with each other. That's peace.
I don't know if your mic was.
Ascribe to the Lord the honor to his name, bring offering and come into his court. Before we start communion, I just want to let you know that the way we do communion here in the Anglican Church is any baptized Christian is welcome to the altar. If you come up to the rail, what we will do is dip the body into the blood, dip the bread into the wine, and if you'll put your hand out, we'll give it to you. So you're not going to get the chalice and the body or the wafer. But if you're not all that crazy about taking communion, but you do want to receive a blessing while you're here, if you come up to the rail and cross your hand, we'll pray God's blessing over you. All right, will you please stand? The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give him thanks and praise.
It is right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give you thanks, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who rose victorious from the dead and comforts us with the blessed hope of everlasting life. For to your faithful people, O Lord, life is changed. It's not ended. And when our mortal body lies in death, there is prepared for us a dwelling place eternal in the heavens. Therefore, we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Together we say, Holy, 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 holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. And so, Father, we bring you these gifts of bread and wine. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and the blood of Jesus Christ our Lord. On the night Jesus was betrayed, he took bread. He said the blessing. He broke the bread and gave it to his friends and said, Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me. After supper, he took the cup of wine, he gave thanks and said, Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me. Father, we now celebrate the memorial of your Son. By means of this holy bread and cup, we show forth the sacrifice of his death and proclaim his resurrection until he comes again. Gather us by this holy communion into one body in your Son, Jesus Christ. Make us a living sacrifice of praise by him and with him and in him. In the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever. Amen. Amen. And now as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah! Christ our Passover has been sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia. These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you and feed on him in your hearts by faith and with great thanksgiving. If you join me in the closing prayer on your bulletin, let us pray. Almighty God, we thank you that in your great love, you have fed us with the spiritual food and drink of the body and blood of your Son, Jesus Christ, and have given us a foretaste of your heavenly banquet. Grant that this sacrament may be to us a comfort in affliction and a pledge of our inheritance in that kingdom where there is no death, neither sighing nor crying, but the fullness of joy with all your saints. Through Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. If you'll respond in the words in italics, give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. You only are immortal, the creator and maker of all mankind, and we are mortal, formed of the earth, and to earth shall we return. For so did you decree, saying, you are dust, and to dust you shall return. All of us go down to the dust, yet even at the grave we make our song, Alleluia, Alleluia, Alleluia. Together, give rest, O Christ, to your servant with your saints. Sorrow, pain are no more, neither sighing, but life everlasting. Into your hands, O merciful Father, we commend your servant, Joseph. Acknowledge, we humbly beseech you, a sheep of your own fold, a lamb of your own flock, a sinner of your own redeeming. Receive him into the arms of your mercy, into the blessed rest of everlasting peace, and into the glorious company of saints in light. Amen. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Please stand for the recessional hymn.
Hallelujah. Let us go forth in the name of Christ.